Reluswami sir and Srinivasan sir, also yes. Take over, please.
Yes, sir.
Can I start, sir?
Yeah.
Okay, so 11-year-old male child, firstborn of a non-consanguineous marriage, coming from Madhuravayal, empowerment mother, reliability is good, but the complaints of difficulty in using the left upper limb and lower limb, and complaints of deviation of the angle of the mouth to the right side for the past 5 years.
The first slide itself, I want to make one comment regarding the reliability of mother. Everybody makes it, no? But usually it has to be reliable. We have to believe on somebody. If the mother says, this is your child, the husband has to believe it, unless some testing is done. So kindly, see, if a mother cannot give, no, she has come all the way. So is it necessary to, because I have seen it has become a routine to say reliability. See, it's not question, unless mother is a chronic alcoholic or she is having some psychological problem, okay. Some others may exaggerate. So I think it is redundant to say reliable, okay. So you can start with a reliable history has been obtained from this thing, okay. But mother is reliable means she has come to your help, so naturally she will give the reliability. It has become a standard practice to say that, but somehow I don't like that, okay. So what about Velusamy? You have to believe what they say. Otherwise, how can you proceed? Yes. Go on.
Mr. Presenting illness, the child was apparently normal when he went to bed the previous night. When he woke up in the morning, he had difficulty in using the left upper limb and lower limb. It was acute in onset. It's not progressive. It lasted for 2 hours. He was not able to lift his left hand above the head. He was not able to grip objects firmly in the left hand. He had difficulty in walking and difficulty in holding slippers in the left foot, but he was able to lift his head from bed. He was able to turn in bed and get up in supine position. It was associated with a deviation of angle of mouth to the right side and drooling of saliva from the left side, but he was able to close both eyes firmly. And he had slurred speech, but he was able to understand and obey commands. It was not associated with loss of consciousness or altered sensorium or loss of sensation, headache, seizures, vomiting, fever, or any other three line of involvement. Child was taken to a nearby hospital, but by that time, after 2 hours, the child was able to walk and use his left hand without difficulty, but the deviation of angle of mouth to the right and slurred speech persisted, and child was referred to KMC. So the child went home, and after 1 hour, child again developed difficulty in using the left upper limb and the lower limb, the same intensity of weakness as before, with the deviation of angle of mouth to the right side and slurred speech. During this event, he had 2 episodes of vomiting. It was not projectile, not bile or blood stained. Associated with nausea, it contained undigested food particles. Again, it was not associated with loss of consciousness, altered sensorium, headache, seizures, or any clinical involvement. Child was brought to the hospital, and here the weakness lasted for 1 hour, after which child again was able to walk and use his left hand with difficulty, but deviation of angle of mouth to the right side and speech persisted.
Now we will stop Dr. Velusamy, and we will ask them to, because it has given some enough information for her to discuss. Shall we ask her to start from the first slide? Dr. Velusamy? Because she has given the salient features of this case presentation, and we can go from the first slide and give your information. What do you think about this child?
Velusamy, unmute, please. Velusamy, unmute.
Is it Palani Raman? Oh, thank you, Palani Raman.
Sir.
Yes, sir. She can finish the history, sir. She can complete the history.
Yeah.
I mean, what is this, sir?
This has almost given the whole diagnosis, no?
Okay.
The whole, first 4 slides. Then we'll go, because then we'll go to the negative history and other. So almost it's the crux, you know, a problem. So she can see how she is thinking is about this child.
Okay.
Yeah. See, it's unusual when compared to other hemiplegias which you have been presenting, isn't it? There are so many things. So kindly interpret each and every slide and tell. And we can ask other PGs also who are there, 2 of them, you know, so they can give their inputs also. Yeah. So first line is very significant. The child was apparently normal when he went to bed the previous night. So that means he was normal. When he woke up in the morning, he had difficulty. Okay, so how do you interpret this first sentence? A very telling sentence, isn't it, Dr. Velusamy?
Yeah, yes.
So overnight, when the child went to bed normally, next day morning, child had problems. So what is the usual teaching, clinical teaching from our undergraduate days?
This hemiversus probably of thrombotic in origin.
So it is not very explosive. Child has quietly gone to sleep without any symptoms the previous night, and overnight child has developed this silently. Okay, so that is good. That means it is not something which is very aggressive. Okay, so what is among the? Okay, next sentence we will go.
He was not able to lift his left hand above the head. He was not able to grip objects firmly in the left hand. He had difficulty in walking. He had difficulty in holding slippers in the left foot. But he was able to lift his head from the bed, and he was able to turn in bed, and he was able to get up in supine position.
Good. Very good history. So what do you interpret in this?
There was weakness only in the left proximal and the distal muscle weakness in the both upper limb and lower limb, but there was no truncal weakness.
Okay, good. So that is the interpretation. Okay, so child is definitely having a one-sidedly paralysis, so indicating of involvement of the brain in the opposite side, isn't it? Okay, yes. Come.
It was associated with the deviation of angle of mouth to the right side, dribbling of saliva from the left side, but he was able to close both eyes firmly.
So now what does it mean? So another information you are given, so how does it help you?
There was a upper motor neuron type of facial nerve palsy.
Yes.
On the left side.
Okay, good. So there is a hemiplegia involving the facial nerve as well as same side limbs. Okay. It's not cross hemiplegia. Okay, good. Proceed.
From this history, will you be able to say the weak about the weakness, whether it is upper motor neuron or lower motor neuron weakness? Facial weakness, it's okay. It is upper motor neuron weakness. What about limb weakness?
Limb weakness, there was no flaccidity.
So what history will you ask to differentiate between upper motor neuron weakness and lower motor neuron weakness?
Stiffness or flaccidity.
Yeah, stiff weakness or flail weakness. But here the history is very short duration, so you will not get the history of a stiffness. Stiffness, it will take some time. So that's why that history is not there. But anyway, you have to ask that history, whether it is stiff weakness or flail weakness.
Okay, sir.
Okay, so this is a facial weakness is human weakness.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so since there is associated human facial weakness, you can consider this left upper limb and lower limb weakness as human weakness. Even though there is no history of any stiffness or flailness, since there is associated facial weakness, human facial weakness, you can consider this left upper limb and lower limb weakness as human weakness.
You have mentioned both eyes firmly, you have mentioned. So the mother has given, so it definitely indicates same side facial. So, and proximal muscles are involved as well as distal muscles. So it's a hemiplegia. Okay, then hemiplegia. Okay.
So yes.
Starting at overnight. Okay, so which condition you think of among the etiological group with this history? Overnight child is sleeping, okay, and child is getting up. Usually we teach in undergraduate days and postgraduate days. What etiology you'll think of?
Thrombotic. Huh? Thrombosis.
Yeah, vascular. Yeah, vascular. You mentioned earlier thrombosis. Okay, thrombosis or embolism, what will you think of?
Thrombosis, sir.
Okay, thrombosis. Of course, in this child, there was no history of dehydration or other predisposing factors. Okay, so embolism will be explosive. It can occur any time of day. Okay, so sudden onset. Even daytime, the child is playing, suddenly they can throw an umbrella. So good. So this is most probably a vascular incident occurring in night. So it indicates probably a thrombotic phenomenon. That's the usual teaching. Okay, let us see. Next slide.
Before etiology, always in neurology, you have to answer three questions. One is there a lesion? Second question is, where is the lesion? Then third question should be, what is the lesion? So there is a lesion. No, there is no doubt, no?
Yes, sir.
Patient has got weakness. It is not a functional weakness. It's not psychogenic. It is not due to difficulty. It is not due to non-neurological problem. Difficulty in using upper limb, lower limb may be due to fracture or some ortho problem also. Okay, so this is only a neurological problem, sure. Okay, so there is a lesion. So first question is answered. Second question is, where is the lesion? You have to localize first. You have to make an anatomical diagnosis first, and then you have to go for pathological diagnosis and then etiological diagnosis.
For a humor, it's a neurological problem because Dr. Velisamy has been asked to be moderating this session, not an orthopedician. Okay, good. Yeah, this is the usual wry humor of Srinivasan. You have to tolerate me.
No, no. Okay. In any case, because sometimes orthopedic problem will be referred to you as a stroke or a hemiparesis. I have seen some cases of pulled elbow referred to me as a stroke by pediatricians. It's a pulled elbow, subluxation of radial head of head of radius. Pulled elbow case referred to me as a stroke. So you have to differentiate whether it is a neurological problem or non-neurological problem. So neurological problem, there is a lesion. Neurological lesion is there. Then where is the lesion? Where and then what? So where will you localize this problem? Patient has got upper limb and left upper limb and lower limb weakness, both proximal and distal
then
weakness. Then
semiplegia. So where do you localize the lesion?
With the facial, human facial weakness.
Same size.
So this is likely to be human weakness. So human means where is the problem? Where is the upper motor neuron?
Where all the corticospinal tract is converging to cause a semiplegia.
Upper motor neuron is in brain spinal cord. Okay. So whether the problem is in brain or spinal cord?
The weakness can be from the cortex, corona radii,
okay.
Internal capsule, midbrain, pons, medulla.
Okay. Yeah.
Now here, where you think is the lesion? So, where it have to stop? Because facial nerve is there. Facial nerve is in which level?
Facial
you said upper motor neuron. So, it's not a cross hemiplegia. So, it is on the same side. So, where is the lesion? Above what level? Brain or? You said cerebral cortex, then corona radiata and internal capsule. So, where is the
lesion? So, is it in the cortex?
In the cortex, there is no history of any seizures or altered sensorium.
That need not be there. Seizure is there, you can say it is cortex. Absence of seizure doesn't rule out.
In cortex, there will be sparse involvement, either monoplegia.
Yeah, usually it will not be dense semiplegia. In cortical lesion, because of the homunculus, because lower limb area is represented medially and upper limb and face area is represented laterally. So it will not be dense semiplegia in cortical lesion. Cortical lesion, usually it will be monoparesis. Upper limb will be involved and there may be facial weakness. So facio-brachial monoparesis will be the feature in cortical hemiplegia. Or sometimes if anterior cerebral artery is involved, there will be lower limb weakness. So dense semiplegia, involvement of upper limb and lower limb and face is not a feature of cortical hemiplegia. If seizure is there, you can say it is cortical. If absence of seizure doesn't rule out a cortical lesion. Okay.
Dense hemiplegia mostly localized at internal capsules.
Okay. No. What's the next structure? You have to say next. So it is not cortex. So is it in the subcortical corona radiatum?
There will be differential weakness.
Again, there will be differential involvement. Either upper limb will be weaker than lower limb weakness, or lower limb weakness may be more than the upper limb weakness because the fibers are sparse. It's not very crowded in corona radiata. So either upper limb weakness will be more than lower limb weakness, or lower limb weakness may be more than upper limb weakness in corona radiata lesion.
Lesion has to be very wide lesion, to cause that. So usually it's not that common when compared to either what he has already described, cortical or internal capsule, because with the dense hemiplegia involved in patient, likely to be internal capsule mostly.
Okay, so it's likely to be in the internal capsule. Why not in the brainstem? You told the premolar tract passes through the midbrain. After the internal capsule, it passes through the midbrain and then pons, medulla, and then spinal cord. Okay, is it in the midbrain?
The midbrain, there will be crossed hemiplegia, ipsilateral third or fourth node palsy with contralateral hemiplegia will be there.
Okay. So pons.
Pons also, there will be crossed hemiplegia will be there.
Yeah. What, which cranial nerve will be affected in pontine lesion?
Pontine lesion 6, 7, 8 will be affected.
Sir. Okay. 6, 7. Okay. Medulla.
Medulla 9, 10, 11, 12.
Okay. So it will be crossed hemiplegia. Brainstem lesion always crossed hemiplegia. That is ipsilateral cranial nerve and contralateral hemiplegia is a hallmark of brainstem lesion. Okay, here it is not.
PG, they may ask you the names of the syndrome, so you should know Weber's, Benedict's, etc. Four-wheel syndrome, Millard-Gubler syndrome, and also Jackson syndrome. So you may have to answer to get more marks, not for just passing the exam, but if you want to get a gold medal or distinction. Or first rank, you may have to differentiate yourself. In the same case, will be given to another PG also on that day. So kindly keep yourself informed. Okay, of course, I'm sure all of you will be knowing this syndrome. Yes. Next,
what is Fovilli syndrome?
Fovilli syndrome will be ipsilateral seventh nerve palsy with contralateral hemiplegia.
6 and 7. Okay, Millard-Gubler.
Millard-Gubler ipsilateral seventh nerve palsy with contralateral hemiplegia.
Okay, Benedict syndrome.
Benedict's is ipsilateral third nerve palsy with contralateral hemiplegia with rubral tremors.
Okay, good. Weber syndrome is ipsilateral
third nerve palsy with contralateral hemiplegia.
Okay, very good. Okay. Is it in the spinal cord?
There will be ipsilateral hemiplegia with contralateral sensory loss, and there will not be facial nerve involvement or face involvement.
So very good. So from the history, you have localized to internal capsule, right internal capsule region. Okay. So that is your anatomical diagnosis.
So the thing is very well described. Now, of course, it's taking a new turn. The next slide is going to. Sure, not the usual case. It going to give a twist to the whole story. Yes, come.
So he had slurred speech, but it was.
You are having slurred speech now. I think some problem with the mic.
No conscious of it, sensory loss, sensation, headache, seizures.
Some mic problem, I think. So there is a crosstalk or something. So slurred speech. Yeah.
He had slurred speech. But was able to understand and obey commands. There was no loss of consciousness, altered sensorium, loss of sensation, headache, seizures, vomiting, fever, or any suggestive of other cranial nerve involvement. Child was.
You have mentioned slurred speech. That is the only positive thing which you have mentioned here. But he is able to comprehend and obey commands. Okay. This gives a very nice new dimension to the whole problem. You said internal capsule. Now, internal capsule, usually speech may not be affected. Okay. So unless it is in the, okay. So what is the new dimension which is given? Other negative symptoms we will not highlight right now. So slurred speech is very characteristic of this thing. Very important significance is there. Okay. So with subsequent slide, you will know what is its importance. So that means there is a wider dimension. Okay, it's not just internal capsule, probably something else is there. But Dr. Velisamy, I would like to give a comment about the slurred speech.
Yeah, slurred speech can occur in internal capsular lesion, in genu of internal capsular lesion, corticobulbar fibers are there. So when those corticobulbar fibers are affected, you can get slurred speech. And patient has the facial weakness. That facial weakness itself can cause labial dysarthria. That may be the reason for slurred speech. Or even subcortical lesion can cause slurred speech. Subcortical lesions, involvement of other structures, that is basal ganglia structures, can cause slurred speech. So in this case, I think the capsular lesion itself, because of corticobulbar fiber involvement, can cause slurred speech, or maybe due to labial dysarthria because of facial weakness.
Good. Next one. Next slide.
So, can you call this as aphasia?
No, sir. Aphasia, there won't be any word output. Yeah, he was able to speak, but the speech was not intelligible.
Okay, so what is aphasia and what is the language and what is speech?
Language is how we communication.
Okay.
Through communication between two people. Speech is articulation and production of the sounds.
Okay. Okay. So language is converting your thoughts into comprehensible modes of communication. Converting your thoughts into comprehensible modes of communication. It involves understanding. It involves reading, writing, repetition, and speech. So that is language. Speech is just it involves only the expression. That is converting language into audible sounds. That is speech. Okay. So language involves understanding, reading, writing, as well as your expressive speech. Okay. So here everything is normal. Understanding is normal, and patient has only slurred speech. That is dysarthria. So it's only a speech problem. It's not a language problem. Okay.
Child was taken to a nearby hospital, but after 2 hours, the child was able to walk and use his left hand with difficulty. But the deviation of the angle of mouth to the right and the slurred speech persisted. The child was referred to a KIMS.
Okay.
So what is the information? So you have mentioned, no, the last, you have given some emphasis to that. Is there any importance?
There was a partial recovery, sir.
Yeah, there is some, that is very important. So there is a quick recovery in some areas. Okay, good. Next slide.
And again, the child went home, but after 1 hour, child again had difficulty in using the left upper limb and the lower limb, but the intensity of weakness was same as before, with the deviation of angle of mouth to the right side and slurred speech. During this event, he had 2 episodes of vomiting. It was not projectile, it was not bile or bed stain, associated with nausea, contained undigested food particles. Here also, there was no loss of consciousness, or altered sensorium, headache, seizures, or adrenal cranium involvement. The child was brought to the hospital, and the weakness lasted for 1 hour, after which the child was able to again walk and use his left arm with difficulty, but the deviation of angle of mouth to the right side and the slurred speech.
A very, very meaningful slide. You have brought out excellent history by mentioning about the progression and then improvement and again this thing within a matter of few hours. So what does it? So this gives a new dimension to this case, whole case. Okay. So what is the importance? Beautiful information you have gathered. So interpret. Am I correct, Dr. Velusamy?
Yeah. Correct, sir. Correct, sir.
So it's coming and going weakness. Yes.
Due to a thrombotic etiology.
The way you have collected information is very good. Yeah, kindly interpret. You are doing a good job. Yeah.
Yes, sir, there was a partial recovery, and again the child had a weakness, like stuttering, hemiplegia. The child had again weakness.
So you said initially thrombosis, okay, but once thrombosis has occurred, it's not going to have this much of repeated recoveries within hours and again occurring. Okay. So what is likely to be another component has been there. See, vessels have some other component apart from embolism, hemorrhage, okay, and this thing. So vasospastic element, okay. So in addition to thrombosis, there is a possibility that the vessels have spastic element. So it goes into spasm and then this thing. Okay, yes. Am I correct? Well, Swami, being a pediatric neurologist, you should correct my wrong thoughts. I have to unlearn and relearn sometimes, you know. No, so old ideas may not be correct these days, yes.
It's correct, sir. So how do you explain this vomiting here? Why vomiting? Is it due to ICT?
There was no other signs of ICT. It was not projectile vomiting, sir.
Okay. So vomiting is a little unusual here. What's the cause, reason for vomiting? I don't know. So it's not a ICT vomiting. There is no headache. It's not a projectile vomiting. So it's not due to increased ICT. So vomiting is more common in posterior circulation strokes rather than in anterior circulation strokes.
Actually, Dr. Velaswamy, this slide, you know, I was reminded during my postgraduate days and undergraduate days, there was a condition known as Bickerstaff syndrome. You know, Bickerstaff was written in a neurology book on clinical examination. So it described a child who is having recurrent tonsillitis because tonsillar fossa is underlying the carotid artery, internal carotid artery. It causes carotid sheath arthritis. So that is the cause of vasospasm, and they may have transient hemiplegia. Okay, that is what I was reminded of when I read this slide. Am I correct?
Yeah, it's correct. Yeah. It's correct, sir.
Yeah.
But only thing is, in large vessel involvement, it will not be so stereotypical.
No. But I am telling the history. No, during our days, this much of arteriopathies have not come. So Bickerstaff syndrome was the one which was being described because tonsillar. That's why we was asked to feel the tonsillar fossa.
Fever, renal involvement. There was no history of any other cranial involvement, no history of loss of sensation, no history of loss of consciousness, altered sensorium, no history of any behavioral changes or emotional disturbances, no history of seizures, no history of bladder or bowel disturbances, no history of any involuntary movements or clumsiness of movements, no history of any fever, headache, blurring of vision or photophobia, no history of painful movements of neck, no history of any head or intraoral injury, no history of fever with rash or chronic ear discharge, no history of...
You mentioned the previous slide, mild fever was there later. So again, don't say no fever because, you know. So you have mentioned, no, the previous slide you mentioned about slight fever. Okay.
There's no fever.
Not associated with fevers. There's no fevers. There's no fever at all, no?
No fever, sir.
No fever.
Okay.
No history of any diathesis, no history of breathlessness or palpitation, no history of facial puffiness or reduced urine output or hematuria, no history of loose stools, no history of joint pain or skin rash, no history of any recent vaccination.
Give the reason why you asked that history, what information you kept in mind when you are asking this. Okay. So whenever a negative history is given, there's a possibility the examiner may ask you, please tell me the importance of that negative history in relation to this particular problem.
Cranial nerve involvement.
Can you say the pathology? That is, what is the lesion? Where is the lesion? You answered. Next is, what is the lesion? Pathology. Whether it is vascular or non-vascular?
Probably vascular event, sir.
So vascular event. Why do you say it is vascular?
The child had symptoms once when he woke up in the morning. And
it was an acute onset. It's a sudden onset.
And the evolution.
The onset is an acute one. And the evolution, recurrent episodes, transient weakness, from which patient ultimately improved. Within 48 hours, patient improved. Okay. So an acute onset, improving, weakness improved. So it is a vascular cause. Okay. In the vascular, now you answer whether it is hemorrhagic or ischemic. Is it a hemorrhagic stroke?
Most probably ischemic, sir, because
why it is not a hemorrhagic stroke?
Because there was no history of any raised ICT signs like headache, seizures, and it was not during any activity or strain. And
so hemorrhagic stroke usually occurred during?
Progresses over hours and will be progressing over hours. It will be late to recover.
Okay, this rapid improvement. This rapid improvement is not common with hemorrhagic stroke. And this is a transient, recurrent transient episodes. That is also not common with hemorrhagic stroke. And there is no headache, there is no seizures. And hemorrhagic stroke usually occur when the patient is active. So it is not a hemorrhagic stroke. So it is an ischemic stroke. Now you say ischemic, whether it is embolic or thrombotic. Is it an embolic stroke?
Embolic stroke also usually occurs when the child is awake during it.
Embolic stroke also occurs when the patient is, child is active. Okay.
And there will be maximal weakness at the onset.
Okay.
It will also improve rapidly. So.
This type of stuttering response will not be there in that. Okay. So recovery will be progressive and will not have again unless other multiple embolization occurs. Okay.
And also the stereotyped episodes, no, embolic stroke, suppose if embolus is from heart, one time it will affect the anterior circulation and other time it may affect the posterior circulation, and even in anterior circulation, one time internal carotid may be affected, second time middle cerebral artery may be affected, third time anterior cerebral artery may be affected. Here it is everything is, all the three episodes are stereotypical. So that is the point against embolic stroke. Embolic stroke usually involves multiple arterial territories. So here it is all the three episodes affecting the same site. All the three episodes are affecting the same vessels. That is unusual for embolic stroke. Okay, is it a, next is thrombotic. Okay, what's the point for thrombotic thrombosis here?
Onset during the waking and the progress of the illness with the recovery.
So onset is the patient gets up from sleep with weakness. So that is a point for thrombotic stroke. And then?
With the transient recovery in between the episodes could be there.
With this stuttering course and the transient episodes, recurrent transient episodes. So that's also a point for thrombosis. Okay.
Same region was involved.
Yes. Recurrent transient episodes and weakness noted on awakening. So these are all the points for thrombotic strokes. So pathology is thrombotic stroke. Okay. So it is a thrombosis involving which vessel? Which vessel?
Probably middle cerebral artery.
Middle cerebral artery, main lenticular stem of middle cerebral artery or its branches?
Yeah, lenticulostriate branches of the middle cerebral artery.
Yeah, lenticulostriate. You're localized to internal capsule. No, middle cerebral artery, if main stem is affected, patient will have other findings, other features, hemiplegia, hemianesthesia, field defect, hemianopia will be there. So it will be a larger infarct. So you have localized it to internal capsular lesion. So it is a lenticulostriatal artery. It's a branch of middle cerebral artery. So thrombosis involving lenticulostriate arteries. Now you say what could be the etiology?
The etiology could be any arteriopathies.
Could be arteriopathy.
Vasculitis. Moyamoya disease. Or any metabolic causes, prothrombotic states.
Okay, either arteriopathy or prothrombotic conditions you have to look for. Either arteriopathy or prothrombotic conditions. Is there any history to suggest it's arteriopathy? Any infective arteriopathy, is there any history?
No, sir.
History-wise, there is no clue to say it is arteriopathy or to whether it is a prothrombotic state. From history-wise, there is no clue. Okay. Now you tell me regarding your negative history, why you asked for all this negative history?
Renal nerve involvement, loss of sensation for localization, sir.
Okay.
Loss of consciousness also can
be... Okay, this is for localization. Okay, if brainstem involvement is there, or not. Okay. Next.
Behavioral changes and emotional disturbances. So again, for localization, the frontal lobe, there could be behavioral changes.
Okay.
Yes. Also for raised ICT signs, also for localization in the cortical area. Any other meningitis?
Okay.
Yeah, sir. And bladder disturbances, again, for
seizures. What about seizures?
Seizures, for local seizure in the cortical area, there will be seizures. Or for any raised ICT signs, there could be seizures.
Seizure means there is some cortical involvement. Okay. So seizures are more common with embolic strokes, embolic and hemorrhagic strokes. In thrombotic strokes, seizures are not common. Okay. Second?
Bladder disturbances.
No, seizures. Suppose if there is a seizure, if there is history of seizure, you have to consider other possibility also, no? Postictal palsy or stroke mimics.
Tots paralysis.
Tots paralysis also you have to consider. No? Yes, so there is no history of seizures. It's no bladder bowel disturbance. It is for?
Bladder disturbance could be there in a frontal lobe involvement.
Frontal lobe involvement. Okay. Anterior cerebral artery involvement. Okay.
But here in this one particular problem, this thing, you know, ictal. Night child might have had a seizure which parents might not have noticed. And then child has recovered. But then here during the daytime also when the parents are awake, child was having improvement and deterioration again. So it's unlikely because they have noticed any seizure in between. So it's unlikely to be seizure related. Yeah. Proceed.
No history of any involuntary movements or clumsiness of movements.
Hmm.
Cerebellar movement, there could be involuntary movements. And coordination could be there. No history of any fever, headache, blurring of vision, photophobia for any meningitis and raised ICT signs.
Okay.
Infective etiology. No history of equal movements of neck for again infective etiology or subarachnoid hemorrhage also can have.
Okay, good. Next.
No history of any head or intraoral injury. Head injury can have contusions, concussion, or any hemorrhage, EDH, subarachnoid hemorrhage can be there. Intraoral injury can injure the tonsil or catheter artery dissection can be there. And embolus, artery to artery embolus could be there. For that history.
Head injury, how it causes stroke? Head injury?
Hemorrhagic stroke can be. So intraepithelial bleeding.
No, one hemorrhage. How it causes ischemic stroke? Ischemic stroke.
Due to mass. Can cause contusions.
Ischemic stroke. So following head injury, child can have cerebral venous sinus thrombosis. Okay, venous sinus thrombosis. And dissection, arterial dissections can occur following head or neck injuries. Carotid artery dissection, vertebral artery dissection, head or neck injuries. Okay.
Yeah, and, so now you tell me facial puffiness and reduce, you not put hematuria and loose stools. What did you keep in mind? It's good history. So you have written, no, very salient points. Tell me, why you have already explained the other things. Now, this facial puffiness, reduce, you not put hematuria. Loose stools.
For nephrotic syndrome and dehydration, and for cortical sinus.
Yeah, loose stools, dehydration, so thrombosis may predispose, fine. Similarly, loose stools and facial puffiness, hemolytic uremic syndrome, that can also cause neurological manifestations, okay? So, and similarly, now joint pain, skin rash. So what is it? You have covered almost all the etiology of arteriopathies. Yeah, that's what I'm appreciating.
Facial puffiness and reduced urine output, even acute glomerulonephritis.
Yeah, hypertension.
Acute glomerulonephritis, hypertension, and can cause, rarely can cause hemiparesis. Hemiparesis is rare, usually presents with hypertension, hypertensive encephalopathy, encephalopathy, and seizures. Rarely, hemiplegia may occur as a complication. Okay.
Then pain, so what about skin rash?
What about fever with rash? You mentioned, no? What for?
Fever with rash for any varicella or viral exanthematous fever can cause post-infectious arteriopathy.
Good.
Anything else?
For vasculitis or HS.
Yeah, some of the vasculitis may present, you know? Yeah, good. a good history have taken. So naturally, we should appreciate, and people should also, other students should know why you have taken this history. Okay, proceed.
What for vaccination? Recent vaccination?
Varicella vaccination can cause post-infectious arteriopathy.
Not post-infectious arteriopathy is rare with varicella vaccine. Any vaccine can cause the demyelination. What are the stroke mimics?
Can cause stroke mimics, hypoglycemia, Dart's paralysis.
Yes.
Metabolic causes, MELAS.
Yes.
And any infections, meningitis, encephalitis, brain abscess.
Okay.
Add a mild demyelination.
Demyelination.
Space occupying lesions,
tuberculomas, all those space occupying lesions, subdural hematomas, and demyelination. So demyelination is one DD for stroke. Stroke mimics. Okay, presentation will be somewhat different. So that's why that vaccination history is important. Not for stroke. Vaccination, varicella vaccine will not cause arteriopathy. I don't know. I'm not aware.
Varicella itself can cause, but not the vaccine so far.
Infection can cause. That's a common. Post-varicella arteriopathy, you have to consider here. If the history is there, you have to ask that history specifically. And the past history also, I think you have to ask. What history you asked for varicella? What is the history you asked? How did you ask that history?
Come to that past history, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Okay, next.
Also, in the hospital stay, the next day the child was improved and he was able to walk normally and use his left hand without difficulty. But the deviation of angle of mouth and right and slurred speech was for another 24 hours. And there was no further weakness during his hospital stay, and there was no residual weakness. Past history, child was diagnosed with large VST at 5 months of age, and patch closure was done at 1.5 years of age. History of febrile seizure at 4 years of age. He was on intermittent clobazam prophylaxis, and he stopped after 2 years. No history of any similar illness in the past. No history of any chronic drug intake, cranial irradiation, viral exanthematous fever, or repeated blood transfusions in the past. Antenatal history, uneventful.
What for cranial irradiation?
Can cause moyamaya arteriopathy.
Yeah, good. It can cause arteriopathy, moyamaya like picture it can cause. What about drug intake?
Drug intake, any prothrom can cause just thrombosis like L asparaginase or can cause amphetamines, can cause.
So drug abuse. You have to ask about history of drug abuse. That is very important. Nowadays, drug abuse is common among adolescents. So drug intake, like that is a L asparaginase. When adolescent girls, OC pills,
amphetamine, cocaine.
And drug abuse. Drug abuse history is very important. Not only cocaine, amphetamine, even some inhalation, some paint thinner, gasoline, all those glue sniffing, all those solvent inhalation. That history also you should ask for. So those drugs can cause vasospasm and can cause ischemic stroke. So drug, even some of the drugs like sumatriptan, which is used for migraine, can cause vasoconstriction, reversible vasoconstriction syndrome. The sumatriptan, triptan that is used for migraine. So that can cause reversible vasoconstriction. So drug abuse is also
In the night it has happened, sometimes, you know, scorpion sting. Scorpion sting has presented as acute hemiplegia. Okay, sometimes, you know, snake bite can cause. Okay, but usually they'll have other presentations. So it's important you think of this thing, you know, insect bite also. But in this case, of course, so they have produced hemiplegia. There are enough case reports of scorpion sting envenomation causing sudden onset of hemiplegia. Okay, yes.
And viral exanthematous fever, what is to you ask for? Varies regarding varicella.
History of fever following rashes or with the rashes.
That is before onset of this problem.
One.
Varicella arteriopathy. usually varicella occurs 8 or 9 months before the onset of this stroke. So you have to ask the history of varicella, not only in the recent past, the remote past, that is in the past 6 months to 1 year, you have to ask for. So that history patient and parents may not be able to tell. You have to probe them. History of varicella in the past, that is in the preceding 1 year, you have to ask for. Recent varicella is more for demyelination and so what are the other neurological features, manifestations of varicella infection?
Sometimes encephalitis.
Encephalitis. Common presentation. Neurological.
Demyelinating.
So demyelination, okay, common. Varicella. Cerebellitis. Cerebellitis is common. Okay, neurological manifestation of varicella, cerebellitis, encephalitis, ADAM, demyelinating disease, sometimes even lower motor neuron, facial palsy. These are all that are acute manifestations. Whereas arteriopathy, history may be in the past, that is in the preceding 6 months to 1 year. So that history you have to ask specifically. History of varicella syndrome? In the past 1 year, you have to ask for.
What is Ramsey-Hunt syndrome? These are all for additional marks.
Ramsey-Hunt syndrome, post-herpes zoster, there will be lesion in the ear canal, sir, in the facial nerve distribution.
The zeniculate ganglion. Zoster involving the zeniculate ganglion. Okay.
Yeah, next slide.
Antenatal history, birth history, postnatal history, uneventful, developmentally normal child, studying 6 standard with average scholastic performance. Immunization history, immunized up to age according to national immunization schedule, last vaccine 10 years of age, no optional vaccines were given. Nutritional history, calories were 1780 kilocalories as against 2190 kilocalories with 400 calories deficit. Protein was 32 gram intake with as against 39.5 gram with 7.5 gram deficit. So, family history, there is no history of any early stroke or a heart disease or a migraine or hypertension in the family members. Other siblings 8 years old and it's normal. There is no history of a contact with the open case of tuberculosis. And socioeconomic history, lives in a pucca house with 2 rooms, separate kitchen and toilet, no overcrowding, drinks unboiled canned water. Father is a 12th standard painter, earns 2,000 per month. According to modified Kupusami scale, it belongs to upper lower class.
Okay, now that you have mentioned painter, father's profession. So what is painter to do with neurological problem? Dr. Thangavelu, he has recently mentioned this thing. So painter and this thing, so what neurological problems can occur? The person who is there. Of course, the child is an older child, but a small child. Lead encephalopathy, okay? So, lead peripheral neuropathy can occur. Okay, but this is not telling, but when you are mentioned specifically painter, they may ask you a question to see whether the possibility of this thing. So, lead is now supposed to be not there in the paints. So, strict regulation is there, but still there are some companies which are having lead paints. Okay, proceed.
The paint thinner abuse, that inhalation can cause vasospasm and can cause a stroke. Paint thinner.
Yes, sir.
What about family history? You mentioned about family history. Why did you ask for family history and what you have in your mind? Early stroke, heart disease, migraine, hypertension.
For inherited prothrombotic conditions.
Like inherited prothrombotic conditions like?
Protein C, protein, factor V laden mutation. Methyl tetrahydrate polymerase mutation.
Okay. Can you know anything about genetics and stroke? Can you mention some of the genes that are implicated in strokes?
Their genes are everything, so they cannot remember all the genes unless they come specially prepared for the class. Okay, growth hormone, there are hundreds of genes. Duchenne muscular dystrophy, hundreds of genes. So cystic fibrosis, there are hundreds of genes.
Okay,
so,
okay.
you can't take. Of course, for a person who tells that, you'll get a super distinction.
Yeah, this not only extra for giving extra marks only.
Okay. In case the other case you don't do well, if you get more marks in this case, it will add to this thing. Okay. Yes.
Okay. Okay. Fine. Proceed.
Okay, summary. The 11-year-old developmentally normal male child born of a non-consanguineous marriage with history of 3 episodes of left hemiparesis associated with left ileum and facial palsy and slurred speech within 24 hours with partial recovery between the episodes and 2 episodes of vomiting with no history of any fever or symptoms or seizures with the past history of VST closure 1.5 years of age and 1 episode of febrile seizure at 4 years of age.
So, of course, this particular point is congenital cardiac disease. And then some intervention has been done. So how is it linked to this thing, stroke? So I already mentioned this, just to complete it. Okay. So they have done a surgery. So after so many years, can it cause thrombosis or thromboembolism?
If there is a residual shunt.
We already discussed the possibility. Just I'm asking because you reiterated that, VSD closure again. So I thought, because whenever a congenital heart disease is there, we are thinking of embolic phenomenon. Similarly, so is it possible that child has... So the examiner who has not been listening at that time suddenly may wake up and then ask, okay, examiners sometimes they travel overnight to come, and they'll be so tired. So they must not listen to what you said at that time. Suddenly they may wake up and ask. So what do you think? Okay, yes. Any of you answered this? We have already come to thrombotic phenomenon as a possibility. Okay, so but is it possible that after so many years such child can have problem?
If there is a residual shunt present, means it can have problems. Otherwise,
okay, good. Next, let us go to the examination. Shall I go, sir? Velusamy?
Yes, sir. Yes. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. What's a residual shunt means? What do you mean? What is paradoxical embolism?
Paradoxical embolism due to a right to left shunt, the embolic can bypass the lung and can enter systemic circulation.
Okay, so it should be then right to left shunt. Then. Okay. Okay.
General examination. Child is conscious, oriented time, place, and
so history-wise, there is no clue for etiology. Okay. So pathology, it's a thrombotic pathology involving lenticulostriate vessels. The internal capsular region, right internal capsular region. Okay.
Doctor Kunju stressed, if you take a very good history, you can almost come to 99% accuracy. So you have taken a very good history and you are able to come to a definitive diagnosis by this time. Now we have to only confirm whether the findings are going to correlate and the same diagnosis there after the examination findings. Am I correct, Dr. Velusamy?
Yeah, yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So we have pinpointed the problem. Yes.
Neurology history is very important. History taking, it's not history taking. Actually, our teachers used to say it's the history digging. You have to dig the history.
Correct.
You have to dig the history. And history, from the history, you have to make a diagnosis. If you're not able to make a diagnosis in the history, it's very difficult to make a diagnosis from examination. Examination will just confirm your history diagnosis and it may add some points.
And so history of, we also give marks in the examination. So 50% of marks are allotted for presentation of history. Here you have got more than 45 out of 50. Okay, yes.
So always the 3 questions to be answered in any neurology case. Is there a lesion? Where is the lesion? Then you have to answer what is the lesion. What is the lesion? The pathology and then etiology. So you have to follow this step in any neurology case. You have to answer these 3 questions. Is there a lesion? Where is the lesion? And then what is the lesion? What is the lesion? The pathology and then etiology. So this should be your approach in any neurology case. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Examination.
I have given 45 marks. I want to ask our pediatric neurologist, as a specialist, how much you'll give for the history out of 50?
Yeah, it's a very good history, sir. I'll give more than 45. Maybe.
Okay, 40. Good. Yeah, so good. Well done. So almost half the well you have crossed. Yes. Now, for distinction with your examination findings, proceed.
The child is conscious, oriented to time, place, and person. It's a right-handed individual. There's no pallor, icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, pedlidema, or generalized lymphadenopathy. The attitude of the limb is left upper limb, shoulder adducted, elbow extended, wrist neutral, fingers semi-flexed. Left lower limb, hips neutral, knee extended, ankle neutral position, toes flexed, sir. In head-to-foot examination, there was no dysmorphic facies, no neurocutaneous markers. There are no markers for infective endocarditis. Vitals, heart rate.
Yeah. Just the previous slide. Yeah. Will you go to the previous slide? Yeah. You have mentioned no pallor. Okay. What is the importance of pallor with hemiplegia?
Iron deficiency, anemia could be a reason for a heart rate.
So what are the types of anemia which are associated with vascular arteriopathies?
Iron deficiency anemia, sickle cell
anemia. Oh, if they come from some tribal areas near Salem and this thing and all, no? So sickle cell disease, then what are the Fanconi's anemia can have arteriopathy? Iron deficiency anemia, prothrombotic state. Of course, I don't know whether you are listening earlier to a hemiplegia program. Undergraduate program, I think, by Dr. Lima Paulin, sometime back. First undergraduate PG discussion was there. I don't know whether you attended. So she has asked all these questions. Okay. So, and similarly, you mentioned, no, collagen vascular disorders can cause. So naturally, you mentioned about this thing. So rashes and other things like lupus erythematosus, polyarteritis nodosa. Skin is important. Of course, you have mentioned later about skin. Okay. Neurocutaneous markers. What did you mean by neurocutaneous? Of course, dysmorphic facies, you kept in mind which condition in arteriopathy?
Down syndrome.
Okay.
Down syndrome.
What are the other chromosomal syndromes which can cause arteriopathy?
Down syndrome, Marfan syndrome, Allegheny syndrome.
Okay. Yes. What about pseudo-Turner? Okay, now your neurocutaneous markers, which are the conditions you kept
Williams,
in mind?
Williams syndrome, yeah, can also cause arteriopathies.
Yeah.
Down syndrome and Marfan syndrome, homocystinuria.
Yeah, yeah.
You have to look for Marfanoid features in even homocystinuria. And regarding iron deficiency anemia, how it causes strokes? What's the mechanism for stroke in iron deficiency anemia?
There will be an alteration in hemodynamics and prothrombotic. So there will be
prothrombotic. One is by thrombocytosis, increased platelet count, and also it increases stickiness of platelet.
Yeah, viscosity. Iron deficiency anemia initially causes thrombocytopenia, but when severe less than 5, it causes thrombocytopenia. So early iron deficiency anemia causes thrombocytosis and increase viscosity. Okay, then of course later severe thrombocytopenia will occur with severe iron deficiency anemia. Okay, proceed.
Neurocutaneous markers or neurofibromatosis.
Yeah, fine.
Okay, only neurofibromatosis or anything else?
Churge-Weber syndrome.
Churge-Weber. Even tuberous sclerosis. So you can get a myomaya-like picture. Okay.
Vitals, heart rate 92 per minute, regular in rhythm, normal volume.
Any other skin examination, neurocutaneous syndrome you mentioned, previous slide, any other findings for skin examination?
For connective tissue disorders, any rash?
Apart from connective tissue disease, you have to look for, which I mentioned previously, scars. Chickenpox scars. Mother may not be able to tell the history of chickenpox, but you have to see any scar is there or not. Sometimes scars may not be very florid in the rashes, chickenpox rash. Child would have had only few rashes. Mother would not have noticed those rashes.
Very important. I remember in Hyderabad, one PG presented a case of this thing. Okay, neurological case, but he has not interpreted that rashes, chicken pox. Similarly, in Jipper also, once rashes were there posteriorly. Okay, it's a neurological case, again missed. So both of them didn't pass in that particular long case. Okay, so kindly remember that, yes.
So rash may be a few rashes. which mother would not have noticed those rashes. So that scar may give some clue. And some rare conditions also you have to think in skin examination. What about Fabry's disease? It's a very rare condition.
Angiokeratomas.
Yeah, you have to look for angiokeratomas. Where do you look for angiokeratoma?
In the perineal region, scrotum back.
The trunk, the abdomen, lower abdomen.
Chest, abdomen and thing, yeah.
Lower limbs. Okay.
Proceed. Victor's heart rate is 92 per minute, regular rhythm, normal volume.
How much more time is there for this case?
25 minutes.
Okay, fine. Enough time is there. We already discussed most of the things. Come on. Proceed.
No specific character, felt equally in all superficial peripheral vessels. No radio-radial or radio-femoral delay. Respiratory rate was 20 per minute. PP 170 in right upper limb and 110-78 in left lower limb. Temperature 98.4 degree Fahrenheit. SpO2 was 100% in room air. Anthropometry, weight 31 kg, height 138 cm, BMI 16.3, all false between 25 to 50th percentile. CNS examination.
The height and other things very important to know. That we mentioned about Turner syndrome in a female pseudo-Turner, then homocystinuria and all, no? Upper segment, lower segment. If the child happens to be tall, so they may ask, you mentioned my anthropometry, normal, but they may ask questions in between. So what is the relevance in such a case? So you must be able to, again, bring back the facts which have been mentioned. Okay, yes.
What about short stature? Tall stature is okay, morphon and homocystinuria. It's short stature and stroke.
Female means Turner's, I already told. What about this thing? Male.
Down syndrome.
Mitochondrial disorders.
Malos.
Mitochondrial is a clue for mitochondrial disorders or other genetic causes, other chromosomal disorders. Malabsorption syndromes. Okay. And in general examination, what about eyes? Have you mentioned anything about eyes?
There is no cataract, there is no lens dislocation.
Okay.
No poly condition or no pale.
What about
cornea? Is important in any hemiplegia, I must feel the carotid pulse also. Okay, by the, not both hands at the carotid, but you have to feel. I mentioned about Bickerstaff syndrome, no? So in the auscultation, we have to auscultate over the carotid for Bruin. So it may indicate this thing. So remember, when you're talking about pulse, kindly specifically mention pulse in all the areas. Okay, yes.
So how do you palpate carotid? Internal carotid, how do you palpate internal carotid artery?
It's as important as this thing, you know. Before taking arterial sample, okay, for ABG, you palpate. What is the sign? You palpate both radial artery and?
Valens.
What is that sign? Similarly, when a hemiplegia case is there and you are thinking of thrombosis or embolism, especially thrombosis, you have to always feel the carotids, okay? And whether you can find sometimes difference in the carotid, okay? So we have seen such cases and also Bruin we have heard. Okay, yes.
So internal carotid, you can't palpate. So you can palpate only common carotid artery.
That's why internal carotid, those days MBBS students were asked to put a glove and feel inside the tonsillar fossa. So you remember, sir? That
yes,
is how
yes,
we
sir.
Have been taught.
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
And examination of eyes, something more in examination of eyes, general examination. General examination, you come to general examination. You have mentioned, what about eyes? You have not mentioned anything about eyes. Cataract, you told. What about cornea? What will you look for in cornea? In family history, you ask for something, no? Family history of premature cardiac death.
Arcus.
Yeah, you have to look for Arcus, Arcus juvenilis. And Fabry's disease can cause some corneal dystrophies.
Okay.
Okay, then subluxation of lens can cause iridodonosis. Iridodonosis. And what about fundus? You'll be
in coma, fistula, and marfan. They'll have dislocation of lens.
And and what about Horner syndrome? What's the importance of Horner syndrome here?
Horner syndrome, if medial lateral medullary syndrome, there will be Horner syndrome will be associated.
So. Yeah, yeah, good, good. In brainstem strokes, you can get Horner syndrome. Very good. And then, a child with a stroke with history of trauma.
In case of karate.
And there is history of trauma to neck, and child has got stroke. So Horner syndrome indicates, sir, internal carotid artery dissection.
What are the four components of Horner syndrome?
Meiosis, anhidrosis, ptosis, loss of ciliospinal reflex.
Pseudoptosis or ptosis?
Nophthalmos.
Nophthalmos. Good, good.
Okay.
Good. So always look for Horner's in a child with stroke, especially when there is history of trauma. You have to look for Horner's syndrome to rule out a dissection. Okay. So if there is Horner's syndrome, your clinical diagnosis should be carotid artery dissection. Okay.
CNS examination, higher mental function. The child is conscious, oriented to time, place, and person. Right-handed individual. No emotional instability. Dysarthria is present, able to comprehend, memory and intelligence normal.
How did you test memory and intelligence? 11-year-old child.
For past memory, I'll ask about his name of the school. Recent memory, I gave him numbers to sir.
Okay, I thought you asked him to sing a old film song and a new film song. Okay, yes.
So how do you test handedness, sir? Handedness.
Handedness, give me an object which
Did you give? Did you try to find out? Don't tell. Examiner can catch you. The people have, without doing color testing, they have told, we have done the color vision. But finally, when asked, no, they, nobody has, mother told, no, she didn't ask. So they can catch you. So if you haven't done, you must not say. Similarly, fundus examination, or this thing, you should not say, I have done it. Okay, that is very important. Otherwise, you may be doing everything well, but one simple lie, if the examiner catches you, then that will be end of that particular case. So kindly be honest when you are answering. Okay, in case you haven't done it, don't say that. Yes. Am I correct? Yes, yes, yes. People yes, get yes, caught yes. like that.
Yes.
Yeah. Sometimes examiners try to find out and then ask the person, especially in DNB examination, there will be translators because they come go to another place. So when it happened that we asked in ICH, okay, so that she said, sister, help me. But the sister said, no, she didn't ask. Okay. After that, we didn't want to fail her, but she became nervous and started fumbling and doing wrong things after that. So your confidence comes down. So never tell lies. It's very important lesson in examination. If you are honest, you are this thing saved. Yes, proceed.
So handedness goes with awareness. Handedness goes with awareness. Ask the patient to look through a keyhole. Ask the patient to look an object through a keyhole. So which eye he uses, you see. So handedness goes with awareness. So if he sees with the right eye, means it's a right-handed individual. Another test is ask the patient to lock his hands. That is to cling both his hands. So dominant thumb will be downwards. If he locks his hands, the dominant thumb will be downwards.
Okay. Yes, so these are the, thank you. So I have come to know this particular point.
So, and even ask the patient to stand in a stand at ease position. So the dominant hand will be upward. Dominant hand will be upward. So these are all some of the bedside tests we can do.
But still, regarding the establishment of permanent dominance, still research is going on.
Yeah, yeah. There are some bedside. These are all bedside tests. Yeah. There are so many other tests out there.
Yeah.
And investigations, you can do EEG, you can do functional MRI, you can do other tests, WADA tests. There are so many things are there. Simple bedside test. These are some of the simple bedside tests.
Yes.
Okay.
Proceed. Yeah. Good.
Nasal nerves. The child can appreciate smell in both nostrils.
Smell only positive things. Yeah. Cranial nerve still a positive thing. Rest of the things we'll take it as normal.
Deviation of angle of mouth to the right side. Obliteration of nasolabial fold on left side. Was able to close both eyes tightly. Was wrinkling of forehead present.
Yes. So that is suggestive of. And yes. Other lower cranial nerves are normal.
All the cranial nerves are normal, sir.
Okay. All other cranial nerves are normal. Yes. Okay.
So it is human facial palsy or element facial palsy?
Human type of left facial palsy.
Human facial palsy. So what about emotional testing here? Emotional fibers, how do you test? So what happens to emotion in human facial palsy?
Be preserved, sir. In human.
So maybe preserved or maybe affected. Okay. In element facial palsy, it's a total paralysis. Both the emotional as well as volitional movement will be affected. Whereas in human facial palsy, may be dissociated.
Well, this question was asked by Lima Paulin yesterday. If you listen to Lima Paulin yesterday, this question was asked. You were there yesterday for the neurology case discussion? No. Okay. Yes.
So maybe dissociated. If they ask the patient to smile, there may not be any facial weakness. There will not be any deviation. But voluntary movement, if you ask the patient to say E, there will be facial deviation. So emotional palsy may occur in human weakness, or emotional dissociation may occur, or in other words, patient may have total palsy or only volitional palsy or only emotional palsy. So dissociation is possible in human lesion. Dissociation is not possible in element lesion because element is the final pathway. So all movements will be affected, both voluntary as well as emotional movements. Whereas element, there may be dissociation. There may be dissociation. If there is dissociation, you can say it is element lesion. If there is no dissociation, you can't say whether it's element or element. Okay.
I know why you didn't attend yesterday, the neurology case. After all, it's a PG discussion, no? So you are preparing for this presentation. Yeah, you must always listen. See, I never get bored, tired of listening to Lima Paulin or Bhuma for the first time. No? So it is all arranged for you. You should have attended that. Yeah, each case is an interesting case. We learn something new. So whenever such opportunities are there, don't miss it. Okay. Yes.
Motor system, bulk is equal on both sides. Tone is normal in right.
No, in examination, what about fundus? Have you mentioned about fundus here? Cranial nose.
Cranial nose, fundus is normal, sir.
You mentioned, no? So what do you want to look for in fundus, sir?
Papilledema.
So fundus examination is very important.
Tuberous sclerosis, we have mentioned about so many things.
Eye is the window to brain. It said that eye is a window to brain. That too, fundus examination is a window to brain. So through the fundus, we can see the brain. So what are all the things in a stroke case? What are all the things you look for in fundus?
Papilledema.
One is papilledema. Papilledema is more common with the venous strokes. The venous sinus thrombosis, papilledema is more common. Okay, next.
Sir, we have okay. 10 more
okay.
minutes, sir.
Okay, you can look for other evidence for infective endocarditis, a rot spot, and any other evidence for bleeding. Subarachnoid hemorrhage, there will be subbiliary bleed may be there. And optic disc anomalies, what is called as morning glory sign. Morning glory sign, some optic disc anomaly called morning glory anomaly is there. It is associated with intracranial vascular abnormalities, intracranial vessel abnormalities, like myomaya disease. Some of the children with this anomaly, morning glory disc anomaly, may have intracranial vessel abnormalities, may develop myomaya syndrome or myomaya disease. Okay. And some torturous vessels are seen in some of the genetic causes, like a call for mutations. So look for vessel abnormalities in any child with a stroke, and optic disc anomalies, papillary edema, bleeding, and other evidence for infective endocarditis. Okay. Next.
The system bulk is equal on both sides. Stone is normal in the right upper limb and lower limb, and hypotonia in the left upper limb and lower limb. So power, it's normal on the right side. In the left side, in the shoulder abductor is 2/5.
Why hypotonia? What's the reason for hypotonia? So it's only human, no, human palsy. You are thinking in terms of only upper motor neuron lesion. Why there is hypotonia here? So you expect only hypertonia, no?
Hypertonia will take time to develop.
Yeah, it will take some time. So patient is in shock now, spinal shock. Okay, so what is stone?
Partial contraction
of a resting muscle. Partial contraction of a resting muscle. So it is a resistance offered by muscle to passive movements. Okay.
Power is normal on the right side, sir, 5/5. On the left side, in the abductor is 3/5. In the flexor, 3/5. In extensor group, 2/5, sir. In the elbow, flexor is 3/5, extensor 2/5. Wrist, flexor 3/5, extensor 2/5. Hand grip was good on the right side and weak on the left side, sir. In the lower limb, in left side, hip abduction and flexion was 2/5. Adduction extension was 3/5. In knee, flexion was 2/5. Extension was 3/5. In ankle, plantar flexor was 3/5. Dorsiflexion was 2/5.
Okay, it's a pyramidal distribution of weakness. Usually, it will take some time for this pyramidal distribution of weakness to occur. Within 2 days, you may not, you will not be able to. You told patient is in spinal shock, tone is reduced. So this type of pattern, it will take some time to develop. Okay, it's the pyramidal distribution of weakness. You know what is pyramidal distribution of weakness?
There will be weakness in the anti-gravity muscles will be affected.
In upper limbs?
Upper limb flexion will be affected, sir.
So extensors will be more affected. Shoulder abduction, elbow extension, wrist extension, and finger extension will be more affected. In lower limbs?
Flexors will be affected.
Yeah, dorsiflexors of ankle, knee flexion, hip flexion will be more affected. Okay.
Superficial.
So here it is uniform involvement, both upper limbs and lower limbs almost equally involved. Okay.
Superficial reflex, conjunctival reflex and corneal reflex were present on both sides. Abdominal chemistry was absent on the left side. Plantar was flexor on the right side and extensor on the left side. Deep tendon reflex.
What are the components of extensor plantar?
There will be a dorsiflexion of the great toe with fanning of the other toes.
Fanning of other toes, and there is mild dorsiflexion of ankle and contraction of hamstrings and tensor fascia later. So it's a extensor plantar components. So great toe extension, fanning of other toes, dorsiflexion of ankle, contraction of tensor fascia later and hamstrings. Tensor fascia later contraction will be more than hamstrings contraction in extensor plantar. Okay.
Deep tendon reflex was present on both sides. Biceps, triceps, supinator, knee and ankle reflex are present on both sides, are normal. Coordination, finger-nose test, finger-finger-nose and heel-to-knee, dysteinokinesia was normal on the right side. It could not be done on the left side, sir. There was no involuntary movements.
Yeah, but it's nothing significant you can skip because time is nearing. So tell it's normal, no, I couldn't find anything. Yes, 5 minutes only is there.
Sensory system, cerebellum are normal, sir. Spine and cranium normal. There were no meningeal signs. In CVS, S1, S2 heard, no murmur. or respiratory system and abdomen are normal. Diagnosis was acute cerebrovascular accident, left hemiparesis with left UMN facial palsy, probably a capsular infarct involving the lenticular right branch of middle cerebral artery, probably thrombotic in origin. VST patch closure was done. Differential diagnosis, I'll take a differential diagnosis, arteriopathy, either a focal cerebral artery.
Patient has got left hemiparesis, probably capsular infarct involving left lenticular right branch. You have to mention the side. I mean, right side.
Right capsular infarct with the right.
Okay.
This right branch of the cerebral.
Okay.
So investigations.
Investigations. Investigation of choice will be MRI with MRI and MRV, including the.
Is there available or this thing has been done for this child?
Yes, sir.
Just you have the pictures.
Is not
so we have discussed the case in depth. So I think if you have analyzed this case and they have investigated the case thoroughly, you can tell what are the things you have. Anything available? Or new case, not worked up yet?
The investigation was done, sir. MRI revealed ischemic impact in the carotid and putamen with the hemorrhagic transformation was there, sir.
There was no Moyamoya sign?
No, sir.
Okay.
Then other investigations were found to be normal, so CBC, lipid profile.
You don't have the pictures?
No, sir.
Okay, proceed. Yeah. This is the last slide you have?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so the child is still there in the ward or discharged?
Discharged.
Okay. So what is the management and what is the advice, counseling?
Management.
Investigations, how do you proceed? Investigations.
Investigation of choice will be MRI with MRI and MRV, including the neck vessel, sir.
Okay.
And then CBC.
What's the role of CT brain? Is there any role for CT brain in stroke?
CT brain can be used to rule out hemorrhage if the MRI is not available.
Okay.
It can be seen, done to rule out hemorrhage. You can also find the mineralizing angiopathy of lenticular striatum.
Okay. So mineralizing angiopathy is in only in younger age, in infants less than 2 years of age. That is so you can do CT scan brain if there is history of trivial trauma and if the age group is less than 2 years of age. Okay, so that will show the mineralizing angiopathy. The calcification of the basal ganglia region will be there. If you suspect hemorrhagic stroke, you can do CT brain. Okay, so MRI and MRA of brain. And neck vessel also should be included.
Yes, including
in ischemic strokes. If it is hemorrhagic stroke, then it's okay. You can do MRI and MRA of brain. If it is ischemic, if you suspect ischemic stroke, you have to do MRI brain with MR angiogram of brain as well as neck vessels. Okay. Okay then.
And I look for a CBC.
CBC.
Anemia, iron deficiency anemia, or polycythemia, thrombocytopenia, thrombocytosis.
Okay.
And
peripheral smear.
Sickling test.
Okay, sickling. How do you rule out sickling?
With the bedside.
What's the screening? Screening tests.
Sodium metabisulfate can be added and covered to look for sickling.
Okay. Sodium metabisulfate. Yes.
ESR.
Okay.
Vasculitis
workup
can be done, sir. ANE.
Okay. If you have any clue clinically, if you suspect vasculitis, if there is any clue, you can go ahead and do vasculitic workup. If there is, in this case, clinically there is no evidence for vasculitis, so vasculitis workup is a last thing. So the initial investigation should be an imaging, MRI, MRA, brain and neck vessels, and then complete hemogram, peripheral smear, and then cardiac thing. Echo ECG and echocardiogram has to be done. So these are all the initial investigations to be done. Next step, you can do other prothrombotic workup and other thing. Vasculitic workup last. Clinically, if you have any evidence for vasculitis, you can do initially itself. Okay.
prothrombotic state, protein C, protein S, antithrombin 3 levels can be done usually after 3 months.
Okay, okay. When? Why after 3 months? Why not initially?
Initially,
it may be low, falsely low. Okay, those protein C, protein S will be consumed during this thrombotic event. And so it may be falsely low during the initial few weeks. So that's why it has to be done after 3 months. If you are doing initially, then it's okay. You have to repeat it once more after 3 months.
Okay.
Okay.
Then
Amalraj is becoming restless. So you better
hurry up.
Because he is moving here and there. So I'm seeing his body language.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Management, we can go to management. Okay, treatment.
Management initially for the acute stage, support breathing, airway circulation.
Okay.
This child, there was no, sir. If there is an intracranial signs, now manage seizures or...
Okay, child improved. In 2 days, the child improved. So next step, next.
To prevent further episodes, sir, should be started. Okay. Or anticoagulant.
So, anti?
Anti-platelet therapy was started, sir.
See, actually, in Marmani Medical College, we give 40 marks for the long case counseling. So, I would like, Velusamy, how would you counsel such a child? Please tell, as a pediatric neurologist, exactly what will you tell about the parents? Because they'll be worried whether the child will get again. So, would you please tell us so that I will also learn how to...
Yeah, counseling, it all depends upon the cause etiology.
Yeah, yeah.
So in this case, I think etiology is not very clear. So we have to give antiplatelet drugs and procoagulant prothrombotic conditions to be evaluated. We have to evaluate after 3 months, we have to evaluate for prothrombotic conditions. And then how long to continue antiplatelet drugs and antiplatelet drugs, we have to decide later. Probably child may need antiplatelet drug for... maybe for 2 years. Usually we'll give for 1 or 2 years. And we have to repeat imaging. If you suspect arteriopathy, focal arteriopathy, we have to repeat imaging after 6 months or so. And it all depends upon the etiology. And I will also do CSF analysis in this case for ruling out varicella arteriopathy, even if there is no history.
Yeah.
Because the site is somewhat to the basal ganglia, ganglio-capsular region.
Just like SSP, we try to do the measles or this thing. So, I think very good.
So, since the lenticulostate vessel involvement is more common site for varicella vasculopathy.
Yeah.
So, I'll rule out varicella vasculopathy here because it's a treatable cause. So, we have to give acyclovir and steroids, short-term. Short course of steroid and acyclovir.
This question may sound silly. Okay, that initially when the vaccine was introduced, okay, from this thing, Japan, there was a apprehensiveness and there was 1 or 2 cases reported following vaccination. Okay, so is it possible that a vaccine itself can cause this type of arteriopathy?
I'm not aware about vaccine-induced vasculopathy. I'm not aware. So common is the infection-induced vasculopathy is common.
Okay.
Vaccine-induced vasculopathy, I've not come across. I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know about the literature. So.
Okay, thank you.
And counseling, since patient is on antiplatelet drug, I'll also advise about the varicella vaccination. Varicella vaccination has to be advised. Since he will be on long-term aspirin treatment, maybe for 1 or 2 years. So you have to give varicella vaccine if not vaccinated before.
All the more in the COVID season where there is a clotting, you know, they are talking about increased clotting. Yeah.
So what about the indication for anticoagulant here?
Anticoagulants will be started if the child has any cardiac dissection, corrupted dissection or...
Okay, if you suspect dissection... If you suspect cardioembolic strokes, you can give. Then,
or a prothrombotic.
Okay, prothrombotic and cerebral venous sinus thrombosis, you can give. In which cardioembolic stroke you avoid anticoagulant? You have to avoid anticoagulant cardioembolic stroke due to infective endocarditis. Okay, because it's a septic emboli. No? Okay.
So, you did a very good job. I enjoyed listening to Dr. Velusamy as well as your answering and presentation. So kindly attend all the PG programs. Just because you are preparing for this, you have missed yesterday's wonderful discussion. Okay.
Yes,
so probably you are so offensive that you are preparing the slides.
What was the topic, sir? Yesterday's topic? What was yesterday's topic, sir?
Yeah, Dr. Lima Panin is there, she will say.
Yesterday, neurodegenerative, sir.
Neurodegenerative. Okay.
HIV encephalopathy.
Yeah, very good case. All the cases are very beautiful. Beautiful from our point of view, learning point of view, not from the this thing. HIV encephalopathy was very revealing, and the parents came to know HIV status later only. Okay, so have you seen Velusamy HIV encephalopathy case?
No, sir. HIV encephalopathy is seen in adults, not in pediatric
cases. Yeah, in a pediatric. It's a very well discussed case yesterday.
Okay.
And it was like a googly. So, so it came all of a sudden. Yeah. I learned a lot from the last 3 days. So, yeah. So don't miss PGs. Kindly don't go and watch IPL when the classes are being arranged for you. Okay.
But anyhow, IPL start at 7:30, sir. I think.
It's all right, but still the discussion go till this thing, no?
No. We'll finish up by 7:30.
No. Attendance has been good. You said even foreign students are attending.
Yeah, first day, I don't know. Yeah. Other 2 days, I'll find out.
Yeah.
I think Dr.
I learn a lot, so I don't miss an opportunity, especially when specialists, we never had this type of specialists discussing a case.
During
I never miss, So what we haven't learned at that time, we can learn even now. Thank you so much.
What about
Velusamy, sir? I learned so much from you.
Thank you, sir. Thanks, sir.
Dr. Velusamy, nice. Anything questions you want to ask or we can able to wind up?
No, sir. Any question from audience?
I think only chat box has to open it yourself. You can open it and see that.
I think much is there. Questions there. I saw the chat box.
Yes, sir.
But question answer box, nothing is there.
Nothing is there. Chat box also nothing. I think with this, we'll close this thing. And wonderfully presented by Dr. Kaushika. And
nice presentation.
Excellent discussion, Dr. Velusamy. Enjoyed thoroughly.
Dr. Velusamy, thank you. Evergreen, our Srinivasan sir is very useful for the PGs. PGs must be lucky enough to know all these things.
But one important lesson is don't tell. If you haven't done something, please don't say I have done it and get caught. If you haven't seen the fundus, say honestly, I haven't seen the fundus.
That's
a message I would like to give.
You are not done. I am not done, you tell. Accept the thing. Whatever happened, it's all. I don't have time, sir. I'm not able to do it. That's the best way to tell rather than this thing, that thing, and don't tell. And don't tell lie in the exams. I think we'll go to next case. I think next is our vaccines or instruments by Dr. Amal Raj.
We'll have the case discussion, sir. Then we'll have the instruments, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. In that case, you can announce that.
Yes, sir. So that was an excellent presentation by Dr. Kaushika. And thank Dr. Professor Srinivasan, sir, and Dr. Professor Velusamy, sir, for moderating the session and making it more vibrant. In fact, Dr. Kaushika won many hearts here and the hearts of the moderators also. So from a CNS topic, next we are going into next most emotional topic, that is short stature. So to present this case, we have Dr. Divya Mary George from Trivandrum Medical College. She's an MD-PG. And to moderate this session, we have...
Trivandrum. She's from KMC.
Yes, sir.
Manipal.
Okay, sir. We have Dr.